with lots of soldiers dancing attendance upon her. She wasn't glamorous, but she was fun. She was attractive. And people were, of course, amused by her because she was still being the enfant terrible. She was popular, all right, and good value.
Jennifer had a variety of boyfriends, and I can remember an American one and really rather a serious English one. It came to naught in the end. I don't quite know why. Jennifer told me once that she used to get the giggles when people proposed to her. And of course, that must have been rather sort of crushing for people when they, those days young men got down on their knees. And Jennifer sort of giggling away.
She was a bit putting off with her noisiness and her outspokenness and saying exactly what she thought about you and personal remarks and that. She never meant it really maliciously, I don't think, but some people are very sensitive, particularly young men.
In Berlin, Jennifer developed the independent streak that characterised her later life.
Jennifer and her parents went their separate ways in Berlin, partly because they were totally wrapped up in their musical world, and there were so many parties for the young people.
It was then that I think her mother, anyway, made it quite clear that she, once this Berlin life, this lovely life, was ended, Jennifer would have to get a job and support herself, that she wasn't going to be able to just sit at home with them.
Now 20, with no qualifications and no husband, Jennifer went to Portugal to work as a nanny for a wealthy family. It was the first of many such jobs, and although it was badly paid, Jennifer still enjoyed the high life. She was fun to be around, and so was never short of a party invitation. Between jobs, Jennifer would rejoin her family, now living in Taormina in Sicily. Among the bohemian and predominantly homosexual crowd the resort attracted, Jennifer was in great demand. A close friend was the well-known health guru Gaylord Houser, who famously turned down a date with Greta Garbo to be with Jennifer. Houser nicknamed Jennifer the Mermaid of Taormina because of her love of swimming.
He was about 56, and Jennifer must have been about 22. Anyway, there was an instant sort of an attraction. I mean, not a sexual one, but they, you know, were just good friends, and he was amused by Jennifer. And she used to go down there every day, and of course they were great ones for parties at night. And Jennifer was, you might say, the life and soul of the party.
Houser advocated healthy eating, particularly buckwheat and yogurt, but his dietary advice clearly did not rub off on his young friend.
Now, I've got a lovely bowl of Cornish cream, and we'll add that. This is nice and rich. I like rich food. None of this nonsense about yogurt instead of cream. Yogurt is not instead of cream. Yogurt is very good for your breakfast, or if you have a poor tummy, or if you're a vegetarian or something. But for cream, there is nothing better than cream.
Jennifer's mother did not let her daughter linger in Taormina. When her aunt Farah needed a helper, Jennifer was dispatched to Benghazi in Libya. It was here that Jennifer learned to cook and developed her famously robust culinary tastes.
Jennifer was in between her various jobs that she got, and I was very pregnant with my fourth baby, so that's really how she came, because she could keep an eye on the other ones. The cooking she more or less had to take over, but she hadn't a clue. The first Sunday lunch, you know, she was absolutely panic-stricken, but she took to it and got really interested and used to go to the souk and bring the most extraordinary things back.
Now then, what's the most bizarre thing you've ever cooked in the most bizarre place? Is it something you think, what are we doing here?
I'll tell you exactly. I've got it in one. I don't know about you.
Well, you go first.
By mistake, I cooked testicles in Benghazi.
We are talking sweetbreads here, are we?
No, well, I thought they were, but they weren't. They were
yes.
It was before I knew a lot about cooking.
Oh, or anything else.
Yeah, well, absolutely, I didn't know what they looked like.
No, well.
In the 1950s, Jennifer moved to London. She had no permanent home and little money. With nothing more to offer than her domestic skills, she sought out jobs with good addresses and a room attached. This haphazard way of life continued for the next 30 years. In 1964, she became the cook and matron for an eccentric educational establishment, Padworth College, near Reading. The teaching staff included a former Ethiopian Minister of Justice and a monk who was employed to write poetry.
I remember her telling me that she was a matron at some poor girl's school. I don't mean a school for poor girls, but unfortunate girls if she was the matron. No such thing as period pains, darling. I always sent them away if they came to me with period pains.
If anybody had the curse and was groaning, she would give them gin, saying it goes straight to the womb. And she said that was all that was needed for girls. And it seemed to work. I don't think anybody was carted off to hospital.
While at Padworth, Jennifer acquired her first motorbike. The taste for two wheels remained with her all her life.
Oh, hell, I've forgotten my lime squeezer! Ah, no, it's all right. Here it is!
Aged 40, she started working for an African legation, but diplomacy was not one of Jennifer's strengths.
At one stage, for some reason, she got a job at the Ugandan High Commission, or whatever it's called, in London. And this went all right for a bit. She was quite happy with all the people there and cooked for them and did all sorts of things.
Her job was to take the breakfast in to the High Commissioner. And on one occasion, somebody said, I wonder if you take two breakfasts into His Excellency's bedroom. And she said, oh, well, why is that? Is he very hungry? Well, no, he's got a young lady with him in bed. And Jennifer said, no, I'm not taking the breakfast in to the High Commissioner. And they said, oh, everybody's got to have their little bit of fun, haven't they? And she replied, only if you're a complete animal. And she then hurled the breakfast tray to the floor and walked out. But most of her jobs ended with her throwing something and walking out.
Another housekeeping job followed, this time for a family in Montpellier Walk. She stayed for 5 years. It was the longest full-time job she ever had.
I needed a temporary housekeeper cook for a while and put an advertisement in the Times, and there were several responses, one of which was Jennifer's. I thought she was a bit grand, which, you know, when she came, I thought she was a bit grand. But in fact, there was nothing she didn't do. When we had guests, she was great. She'd serve guests. She was a little... She knew some of the guests almost better than we did, I have to admit that. It was quite usual for someone to leap up and give her a great bear hug and say, hello, Jennifer.
We all used to use her when we had a dinner party. And she was extremely cheap. And all she needed was a large whiskey and a great deal of attention. And she would arrive quite often with the food on that little scooter and then wobbled off in the early hours to her extraordinary sad and dusty flat in the shadow of the cathedral.
At the age of 49, Jennifer was forced to rely on her family for a roof over her head when the last